office. And we haven't totally made a decision about the project milestone two, but I think we may delay that until the following Monday. So project milestone two is due on, currently on Friday, so a week from tomorrow. But how many of you have not gotten feedback yet? Okay, so we're gonna have to delay that. I've pestered our amazing TAs who have just been a little bit slow on that to get feedback to you guys by tomorrow. And hoping that happens, we'll just probably still have it due a week from Monday. So a week after homework three.
Also, by the way, Jisoo is going to post two projects from a previous year that won like best project award. So that you just have, you can see what a good project looks like. So you'll do that soon, right, Jisoo?
Yeah.
Okay. I guess that's all we can talk about administratively. So let's remind ourselves real quick where we left off last time. So I'm thinking about a regression setting, likely a high-dimensional regression setting, but not necessarily kind of having strictly more features than samples. That's certainly a case that we keep in mind. So this is our data model. We've got a vector of responses called y, which is some linear function of some predictors called x plus error. And okay, just to emphasize once more, this model is kind of restrictive, especially you might think of it as being restrictive in high dimensions. Types of data that you might observe in high dimensions, you don't know that this would be true. Certainly not with x fixed and epsilon being having some stationary distribution like normal with mean zero and covariance sigma squared I. But it's a place to start in terms of the theory that we developed, which we did for least squares already last time. We'll hopefully get to a bit of that through the lasso today in subset selection. But also to emphasize that these methods make sense whether or not this data model is true. So even if the mean was not linear, even if the errors were, let's say, they had some, let's say, variance that depended on x, so they weren't homoscedastic. Even if the model's misspecified, we could still fit these estimators of the regression coefficients, and just keep in mind that they're doing something like forming a good, hopefully sparse, linear approximation to the mean, even if the mean was not linear to begin with and didn't have this stationary structure with the errors. So these estimators make sense kind of independent of a data model, although to do theory, we have to write something down that's precise like that. So here are the three estimators we talked about last time. We take the least squares loss, which we saw was not didn't yield a unique minimizer when p was larger than n, p being the number of features and n being the number of samples. So we add some regularization in two forms, either in constrained form or penalized form. Here I've just written down the penalized form. And we use three different types of norms for the penalty here. The L0 norm, which isn't really a norm. I don't know if I said that last time, but it's not actually a norm. We call it a norm, but there should be parentheses around that because it doesn't satisfy positive homogeneity. So for example, if I take A times beta and look at the L0 norm of that, that's not equal to A times the L0 norm of beta in general. It's not true unless A is 0 or 1. So a norm has to satisfy this property for all positive A, and this doesn't. So it's not really a norm, but we just call it a norm kind of anyways. The L1 norm, which yields the lasso estimator, and the L2 squared norm, which yields the ridge regression estimator. Okay, so last time we said that two of these estimators yielded sparse estimates of the regression coefficients, and one didn't. And this would be odd man out. So lasso and best subset selection both yield sparse estimates of the regression coefficients. We had some intuition based on a picture for that. Here was another way of looking at it, that was in the notes. Now we're gaining intuition from a special case, that case being the case of orthogonal predictors. That means that X transpose X is the identity matrix. So we just have orthogonal predictors. The columns of X are orthogonal. In that case, the least squares estimator, so okay, first of all, note this necessarily implies that P is less than or equal to M. Right, because here we're saying that the first of all, x transpose x is the identity, so certainly it's invertible. So if it's non-singular, it must have p being small or equal to n. And in that case, so the least squares estimator is well defined. Here's the least squares estimator of the coefficients. It's just x transpose y, but because x transpose x is the identity matrix. And now we can write down solutions for the three problems succinctly, the special case in which all the solutions have closed forms. And the best subset selection solution, we take the least squares estimator of the coefficients, and we hard threshold that by an amount square root of 2 lambda. Okay, the fact that there's 2's here is really not, it's kind of inconsequential. I just put a half in front of the loss because that's convenient for the lasso, and I made everything kind of subject to that scaling, so the threshold level here is square root of 2 lambda if you use a lambda as the penalty for the subset selection problem. So which means to take the coefficients of the subset of the least squares estimator, we compare them in absolute value to the level square root of 2 lambda, and we set them equal to 0 if they're smaller than that. If they're bigger than that, we just retain them. Okay, so clearly that gives us sparsity, and as lambda gets larger, we get more sparsity, right? Because the threshold level is getting higher. The lasso, we use soft threshold, which we've seen before in this class. Now we compare the components of the least squares estimator and absolute value to this threshold, lambda. If it's smaller than lambda, again, we set it equal to 0. But if it's bigger than lambda, then we actually take the value and we move it towards 0 by the amount lambda. So if it's positive, we subtract lambda. If it's negative, we add lambda. It's called soft thresholding. And one thing that differentiates these two is actually continuity of the estimates as a function of the data. Now you can see that basically if the least squares estimator was just above the threshold level, it's going to be whatever the value was. And if it's just below, it's going to be 0, which means that it's discontinuous, right, as a function, let's say, of the data y. If I jiggle y a bit, response a bit, then I'll get either a non-zero coefficient or a zero coefficient, depending what side of the threshold I'm on. This one doesn't have that property. It's continuous because of the soft thresholding action. When you're just above the threshold level, the coefficient is still going to be very close to 0 because you're actually subtracting off the threshold level, let's say, if it's positive. And lastly, ridge regression, you just take the least squares estimate of the coefficients and you divide by the amount 1 plus 2 lambda. So we can see two things. First is that we don't get sparsity. Okay? I mean, generically, these are non-sparse. And here we're just scaling them by some amount. And in a sense, this is shrinking more the larger coefficients compared to the lasso. The lasso is subtracting off an equal amount from every coefficient, right? If the least squares coefficient is, let's say, 12 and lambda is 2, then the lasso puts it at 10. Whereas this is a different kind of shrinkage. It's multiplicative, right? So the large coefficients get hit by, let's say, a factor, divided by a factor of, let's say if lambda is 1, divided by a factor of 3, so a coefficient of 12 becomes 4. So there's effectively larger shrinkage for the larger coefficients. And you can see why that's true is because if you have a large coefficient and the square of that coefficient looks quite bad in terms of the minimization problem, right? So we shrink them more because we're taking the squared components rather than the sum of the opposite. All right, so just some intuition from the orthogonal case. I imagine most of you have seen that or have seen something similar to that. So that's that. Now let's talk about another kind of defining property, or I should say another property that differentiates these three problems. So the first was sparsity, separated two from the third. The next one is convexity. So guys, I've already heard the answer. The L0 norm is not a convex function, which makes the best subset selection problem, the minimization problem, non-convex optimization problem. Typically in this class, we've done some optimization in the past, or at least when I taught with Larry 2 years ago, we did some optimization. This year, we're not really doing that. I decided just to put a really small blurb about convexity, basically in section 2.3 of the notes. How many of you guys took the convex class with me at some point? Okay, how many of you guys have no idea what convex optimization is? Don't be shy. Yes. Okay, so I'm going to just tell you what convexity is, tell you what a convex problem is, tell you why we like convex problems, and then we'll just say, if you're interested in learning more, take the class on conflict optimization. I will be teaching it in the fall, but you're going to have some great instructors from the NL department. And you can always ask me more in my office hours if you're curious. So let's just define a conduct optimization problem. Before I do that, let me ask this. How many people know what a convex function is? Or how many people don't know what a convex function is? Don't be shy. I do want to write down the definition if you don't know what it is. And a convex set. Okay, so I think we're all comfortable with convex functions and convex sets. And the definition's in the notes in case you're curious. Basically, here you go. Here's the answer. That's a convex function. That's a convex set. So just think of those two if you don't know what they are. Convex function lies along above the line segment joining any two points. Convex set is the property that if you take the line segment joining two points in the set, then that line segment lies in the set. Okay? Convex function, convex set. Non-convex function, non-convex set. So that's the definition and sort of like to make it. So here's a convex optimization problem. First, here's an optimization problem. It's one in which we minimize some function we'll call the criterion. Let's call the optimization variable little x, subject to a bunch of inequality constraints on our function. Let's call it hi of x less than or equal to, what do I call it, h? Yeah, hi of x less than or equal to 0 for some j's and our i's. And aj transpose x equals bj for a bunch of different j's. So this is an equality constraint optimization problem where the equality constraints are linear. In general, for optimization problems, these equality constraints could be anything. I could have some function values equal to 0. But our focus is on convex problems. So a convex problem, convex optimization problem, has the following property. F and h1 through hm. So this criterion function and these constraint functions are all convex functions. And as I've written it, these have to all be linear functions. The quality constraints have to be where often these are affine constraints. I write like this. Ax minus bj is equal to 0 for a bunch of j. So I have a bunch of affine functions that set equal to 0. Affine just means linear plus a constant. Right. So that is a convex optimization problem. Let's real quick look at these problems. So these problems have no constraints. These are the penalized versions of the problems. The criterion in each case is the least squares loss plus something, bounty function. And when we take the L1 norm or the L2 squared norm, those are both convex. The least squares loss is always convex. It's a quadratic, and it's Hessian as x transpose x, which is always positive definite, or positive semi-definite, which makes it convex. So this is a convex function for the lasso and for rich regression. For subset selection, it's not, because we're adding a non-convex function to the criterion, that's the L0 norm. Why is the L0 norm not convex? Can somebody give me an explanation for that, or just a counterexample to how it breaks some of these things? So here's the definition of a convex function. It has to satisfy this property. Function has to lie below the tangent line, the line segment joining, not the tangent line, the line segment joining any two of its evaluations. This has to be true for all x, y, and all t that are between 0 and 1. Why does the L0 not satisfy that property? Somebody give me an example. Here I'm going to take the L0 norm of something plus something else. And I want to show that it breaks this inequality.
Nobody has an example for me?
Yeah.
X is 0, y is 1, and t is 1 half.
Okay, so I take 1 half times 0 plus 1 half times 1. Take the L0 norm of that. So, okay, this, you're going to make this a scalar. So this evaluates to 1. Okay, and on the right hand side, we have this should be less than or equal to 1 half times the 0 norm of 0 plus 1 half times the 0 norm of 1. And this thing is just a half. Right, because that's 0. So in that case, it's a fine example. I guess in one dimension, this is really just the property of a positive homogeneity breaking. So we don't have the quite also. So there you go. That's an example that shows that L0 norm is not convex. All right, so why do I like convex optimization problems? So there's two reasons. One is an algorithmic reason. The other is a theoretical reason. So algorithmically, we like convex problems because they're easy to solve, relatively speaking, compared to general form optimization problems. And why is that? It's because of this property, which is that a convex problem has no proper local minima. Which means that if you're at a point in parameter space where you are smaller than everything in a neighborhood of yourself with respect to the criterion, and you satisfy all the constraints. So you're smaller than everything else that satisfies the constraints in some local neighborhood, then you're at the global minimum. You can never have this kind of phenomenon, where this is a kind of a proper local minimum with the convex problem. And the proof of that's in the notes. I think, just for the sake of time, we're not going to go through it. But it basically just uses these two definitions. I didn't define a convex set for you, but uses this definition, the definition of a convex set. It's like less than a paragraph. Okay, so why is that a nice property? It's because it means if we just keep going downhill, if we just keep, let's say, going in directions that decrease the criterion, eventually we're going to hit the global minimum. And most optimization algorithms that we actually know of do that in some way. I mean, it's kind of a loose way of describing them. But it means just going downhill, just go downhill, that's a good strategy. So for example, gradient descent, probably the thing you might say matches that description the closest. Just following the gradient of the negative gradient of the loss function, moving in the direction that decreases the criterion the most in an infinitesimal sense, subject to the constraints. That'll work for a convex problem, won't necessarily work for a non-convex problem. Because you could be stuck in the local minima where it looks like you are at the bottom of the hill, but really you're at the bottom of a hill that's suboptimal. So that's why we like convex problems algorithmically. And it means that things like the lasso and rich regression are easy to solve. Things like subset selection are very, very hard to solve. In fact, subset selection is formally one of the hardest non-convex problems that we know of because it's NP hard. So it means that if we could solve it, then you would have a Turing Award, which would be great. But it also makes it kind of the, like you think it's probably unrealistic that you would find a fast algorithm for subset selection. Okay, theoretically, why do we like convex problems? That is a harder thing to describe succinctly in just like a minute, like we did with the algorithmic motivation, but the idea is that for convex problems, we have a very nice theory of optimality and duality, which basically allows us to conceptually understand the nature of the solutions without actually computing them. So if you take in optimization with me, what I'm referring to are the KKT conditions, for example. We can write down a set of optimality conditions for, let's say, the lasso and ridge regression, which you'll see for the lasso as we go forward, that describe kind of the nature of the solution in some implicit way. And we can actually use that to both understand conceptually properties of the solution and also theoretically very rigorous properties of the solution. So with the lasso, we can actually use these optimality conditions that come from convex optimization, nothing to do with statistics. It treats the problem as, you know, like a deterministic problem entirely. Tells you a set of conditions that kind of characterize the solution. We can use that to prove that under certain conditions, albeit kind of idealistic conditions, the lasso recovers the underlying set of variables in this sparse linear model exactly. So the support recovery proofs the lasso all use these optimality conditions. We don't have the same thing for a non-convex problem like subset selection. We don't have the same thing generically. So even from a conceptual or theoretical point of view, we understand much less about those types of solutions. They're much more challenging to study. So those are the two kind of motivating reasons to, well, first, motivating hopefully for you guys to learn convex optimization and convex analysis. And second, it's a motivating reason to actually design estimators that are convex. So that was our blurb on convexity. And L0 is the odd man out. And for sparsity, L2 is the odd man out. So of these three we've written down, the L1 regularized least squares estimator, the lasso, is the one that's convex and gives us sparsity. So it has kind of a special role with respect to these three estimators. And moreover, it kind of has a special role in general. I mean, things like the lasso that use an L1 penalty or polyhedral penalties like the L1s, they are convex estimators that give us sparsity. But there aren't a lot of things that are totally unlike the lasso's form that actually have both of those properties here. Okay, so we'll learn some maybe next week. But so far as these three problems go, the lasso is unique in that it's convex and gives us sparsity. Okay, now I wanted to move on to some theory for subset selection. So I just told you it was really hard to solve subset selection. And you know, practically, and it's also hard to understand the nature of its solutions from a theoretical perspective, but nonetheless, it can be done. And there's a very nice paper by Dean Foster and Ed George from, I'm not sure if I'm counting right, is that 30 years ago? Is 1994 30 years ago? 20 years ago, okay. I can't do math. So it's 2 years before the lasso paper. So it's from a ways back. But they actually have what I think of as some very nice theory for subset selection that tells you in a certain sense it would be a good thing to use if we could solve it. And then I'll come back to that point shortly after we present the theory. So let's do that. Okay, so before we talk about theory for subset selection, let's raise a very simple point. And this is a reeling fact about the subset selection solution. Let's suppose that we call A the support of the subset selection solution. And by subset selection, we're actually going to be looking at the penalized form. So the one I wrote up there on that board. So suppose I told you the set of variables indices such that those components of the subset selection solution were non-zero. Okay, beta hat is, let's say, the minimizer of the subset selection problem. If you knew that, which we call the active set of the subset selection solution, so these are the set of active indices of active variables, then subset selection actually becomes trivial. It's a very easy problem to solve. Of course, the real challenge is in finding it, so finding those best variables. But if we do this, then the solution is actually of this form. It's going to be, by definition, it's going to be zero outside of the active set. So here I mean I'm taking the components of this vector beta, and I'm indexing the ones that aren't in the set A. So I mean my beta hat sub minus A. So because the support is A, by definition everything's zero outside of A. what is the solution on the active set? Well, if I told you that the solution to the subset selection problem had an active set A, and let's suppose the active set had 10 non-zero coefficients, then the penalty in subset selection is just 10 lambda. It's just a constant, right, with respect to choices of the parameters beta that have that active set. Which means that all we're doing is we're minimizing the least squares term. Right? Because once I tell you the active set again, the penalty is a constant with respect to parameters that are supported on A. So I'm just doing least squares. So I guess that the solution is just the least squares estimator on that active set. Okay, so here I mean I take the columns of X that are in that set A. So let's suppose I told you that subset selection solution shows variables 1, 3, and 10. So I take columns 1, 3, and 10 of x, and I do least squares of y on those. That's what these three coefficients look like. So that's the subset selection solution. And what we can see is that it doesn't have any shrinkage. I mean, this is what we kind of saw intuitively, or we thought would happen intuitively. It just picks a set of variables and does least squares. There's no shrinkage whatsoever, right? These aren't shrunk compared to least squares. And it zeroes out a bunch of other coefficients. And of course, as I said, this isn't a prescription for solving subset selection. The real challenge is in finding A, which is a combinatorial problem, and that's what makes this such a hard problem, is actually this step. And so this is just somehow a fact that's supposed to give us some intuition. Now let's think about the subset selection estimator compared to something that we'll call the oracle. The oracle estimator. This word, I think, originated with some work of Donahoe and Johnstone in non-hermetic regression. Although I'm not positive that that's where it originated, but at least that's one of the early references for it. And it usually refers to a setup in which you know, let's say, the structure of the estimator. So the oracle knows the structure of the estimator, and you ask, what would you do given that structure? What would be somehow like an idealistic estimator if you knew the structure? So in this data, we interpret this as follows. Let's suppose I told you the support set of the underlying coefficients. So remember we wrote on that data model up there, the underlying coefficients being beta 0. Suppose I told you the support set. Okay, I actually told you what the right variables were that in this generative model for y. Okay, I told you the right variables were, let's say, 1, 4, 5, and 10. Then what you would do, if you had that information, is that you would just estimate those coefficients by doing least squares on this unknown oracle. So this thing is only known to the oracle, which is the true support, and you would zero out the rest. Okay, if you never do this, because it depends, like I said, on the underlying regression parameters, and this assumed linear model, but this would be what you would do if you had that access to that information. So subset selection, you can see, is trying to do that, but it has to estimate that active set. So that comes from the optimization problem. So before we talk about, maybe we should call this oracle. So I have a superscript oracle to differentiate from the subset selection estimate. Before we talk about subset selection's risk properties, let's talk about the oracle's risk properties. And here, we're just going to look at in-sample risk. Here, we're just going to look at in-sample risk. And missing an expectation in the equation above 11 in the notes. But what we know from our work last time, is that the in-sample risk of this oracle estimator is just sigma squared times the number of variables divided by n. Sigma squared times the number of variables divided by n. But what is the number of variables in this situation? It's not p, right? Because truly, the oracle knows that the right variables in the generative story for y given x are s. And it's just estimating coefficients in the set s. So actually, its risk only depends on the size of s. We're going to call this little s naught. So I'm going to write little s naught as the size of the support. Okay, so if you redid the calculation we did last time, you would see that this is the risk of the oracle estimator, in sample risk. Sigma squared s naught over n. So this is essentially what we should hope to get close to with estimate, with our estimators, but maybe not exactly attained. Right? This is unattainable if we knew s. Okay, and here, just to be clear, x is fixed, and epsilon is normal 0 sigma squared. Okay, so this expectation is over y. Okay, so Foster and George now have a very nice couple of results on subset selection. And they kind of set the standard for what we should hope estimators to do theoretically in this setup where the mean in a high-dimensional problem is linear, the regression coefficients in that linear mean function are sparse, and they have sparse level S0. Okay, they say that in that situation, if we choose this tuning parameter carefully for subset selection, so if we choose lambda, the subset selection parameter, on the order of sigma squared log p. This means that it scales at a constant times sigma squared log p as n and p go to infinity together. Then, the example risk of subset selection. Selection estimator with this value of lambda, so the guy defined by that problem, that n card problem, divided by the oracle's risk, okay, so this is what they call the risk inflation. It's how much risk do you have on top of the oracle. If this was 1, then subset selection would be matching the oracle. If it was a constant, then it would be only a constant factor worse than the oracle. And what they show is that it's actually, for any x, any x whatsoever, so make that true, with no assumptions on x whatsoever, this is less than or equal to 4 log p plus 2 plus a term that's going to 0 as n and p goes to infinity. Okay, and what we should think of then is that subset selection has risk that's something like, at the rate, log p, s naught over n. So the only thing that really matters here is growing, is this log p. So the risk of subset selection is like log p, s naught over n, compared to s naught over n, which is the oracle. So people usually say then, when they think about this type of result, is that this log p is the price you pay for searching. Variables. Not a very steep price, right? Log p is a very slow growing function. So that's one half of the Foster and George result. And it's actually not a very difficult paper to read because the meat of this is actually to show this is true in the orthogonal case. In the orthogonal case, it's just hard threshold. Okay, so it's an easier problem to study. And there's an argument that lists it to the general x case that's, I think it's, you know, it's nice, but it's you know, the orthogonal case maybe would be enough for you to read and understand. One half of their results. Okay, so now you look at this and you say, well, that's not bad, but is there another estimator that does better? This is the idea of minimaxity. Is log p, it seems like it's growing slowly, but is there something that has constant risk inflation, right, that it gets a constant factor worse than this oracle? And their answer is no. If you look at things in a worst case sense over x, and we'll return to this point next week when we talk about theory more in more depth for the lasso. But here's the second half of the result. The second half of the result says that if you look at the n over all estimators, so this is all estimators now. It's not just subset selection. Okay, and you look at the soup over all matrices X. So in a worst case sense, over all the predictor matrices you could have seen, and all vectors beta naught that are S0 sparse, so that the L0 norm of beta naught is S0 of the n sample risk. This is something like the best possible risk inflation you could expect from any estimator if you look at its worst case behavior over hard S0 sparse coefficients and hard predictor configurations X. This is bigger than or equal to 2 log p minus something that's going to 0 with log p. Okay, so again, in terms of rate, the very best you can expect is log p sigma squared over n. Okay, so there's something to emphasize here, which is this is kind of a weird notion of a minimax result, because we're taking a soup over x here. X is deterministic, right? We're thinking of deterministic, the n sample risk, x is fixed. This is the worst case predictor configuration you could have seen. What would you guys guess is the configuration that achieves this lower bound? So they actually prove this by taking a specific configuration. Is it a very correlated design, or is it a very uncorrelated design? What do you guys think? Who thinks it's very correlated? Who thinks it's very uncorrelated? I'm not very confident. So if I have a lot of correlation, would the prediction error actually be harder or easier? Would predicting the mean be harder or easier? Let's suppose I actually had so much correlation that in fact I only really had like 10 variables. I had p variables, but a bunch of them identical copies of each other, and there's only 10 somehow unique variables in that collection. Would that make estimating the mean harder or easier?
Easier,
right? Because then it doesn't really matter what I select. I all I have to do is kind of select roughly the right things, and if I make a mistake, somehow I picked a variable identical to one that was supposed to be generating y, then it doesn't really matter. As I have more correlations, you can kind of think the same thing happens. You get more for making mistakes with high correlations, because even if you pick incorrect variables, they may be highly correlated to correct variables. So you kind of have more, let's say, room for mistakes. When things are uncorrelated, actually, that's the hardest in a maybe surprising sense, because we think of correlations as being bad in this minimax sense. We think of correlations as being bad in general, but uncorrelated designs are the ones that actually make this lower bound tight, and they prove this. So this is a, let's say, lower bound is attained. Subset selection. We'll come back and discuss this minimax stuff maybe at the end of, or maybe towards the middle of next week. But this just be somehow the motivation for what we want to do going forward. We think that log p s0 over n is somehow the best you can do in terms of rate, and subset selection gives it to us. So at least theoretically speaking, if we could solve subset selection, it seems like we would want to do so from this n-sample risk perspective. Now, I have this blurb in the notes, and this has been here for the last, I think, at least two times I've taught this unit, and I I'll just read it. I say, lastly, it's worth remarking that even if we could compute the subset selection estimate of scale, it's not clear that we want to do this in place of something like the lasso. Many people assume that we would. And then it goes on to continue to say that basically, it's not clear in practice what the sensitivity of the subset selection estimator is to signal-to-noise ratio. In practice, if we had a problem with pretty low SNR, so where we didn't really have, you know, even a true linear model, but those coefficients were small compared to the noise level, because subset selection is not shrinking, right, because it gives us estimates like this, it's really not clear that actually that would do better than something like the lasso, which regularizes. We're going to look at the form of the lasso. We're going to see it actually induces shrinkage. In a low signal-to-noise ratio situation, practically speaking, it's totally unclear which would be better. Most people kind of assume that we'd want, or at least some people assume we'd want to fit subset selection because of properties like this. And then, just coincidentally, in the last year, really, or maybe a little longer, a year and a half, there's been some nice work from some folks in operations research, jointly with folks in statistics, that shown that actually you can compute solutions to subset selection for a lot larger problem sizes than we thought we could initially. Still in an approximate sense. The problem is still NP-hard. Nobody's won a Turing Award yet. But it turns out that you can cast this as something called a mixed integer quadratic program. And those of you who took optimization with me last semester, there was a lecture on this actually. My co-instructor, Javier, gave a lecture on this. So it means that all of a sudden, there's kind of more of a working ground for us to actually practically test subset selection versus the lasso across a wide variety of situations. And if we have time next week, I will show some results on that. And some of us, my dad included, are working on kind of in-depth simulation suite to compare the lasso versus subset selection to try to figure out practically where the trade-offs lie. What SNR regimes is it actually, let's say, hurtful to use subset selection versus the lasso. So if we have time, I'll show some simulations next week, which is not, you know, towards the general theme of doing theory, but I think it's interesting. And it's very recent that we can actually do these things. Okay, so that's, I think, a good point to take a break. Take a few minutes break, and then we'll come back. So before we do, like, kind of more in-depth lasso theory, even before we do that, I want to give you a roadmap for the rest of the time. So at some point, maybe, hopefully, toward the end of today, if not the next time, we're going to talk about some lasso theory. So we're going to talk about what does the lasso do in situations like this. Okay, and I'll give you the punchline now. Maybe my dad is not going to be here next week, so we can talk about the punchline in front of him. So for any x, okay, the lasso's answer to subset selection upper bound is something like this. Okay, so the in-sample risk. So let's make this clear. This is for the lasso. In-sample risk is about, which means the scaling up the rate, S0 times the square root of log p over n. Okay, which is actually not as fast as subset selections as zero log p over n, right? Because we're taking, first of all, we need log p to be smaller than n, right? We can't have an exponentially large number of variables and number of observations. So we're thinking about this as going to zero. And in that case, the square root is going to be quite a bit larger than the ratio of log p over n. So this is Lasso's in-sample risk property. And we're going to prove this, actually. It's not hard to prove. I think it's even easier than the Foster and George result, thanks to basically something like manipulations of the optimization criteria. And now for, let's say, nice x. There's different ways to define nice, but think about low correlations. Okay, not a lot of correlations. Specifically among the active variables, among the variables that are active in the population, so x sub s. We get that the in-sample risk is back to S0 log p over n. So we sometimes call these the slow rates and these the fast rates. one thing that was new in the notes this year is that I have the proofs for all of these results in the notes. So the fast rates, the slow rates, we have oracle inequalities, support coverage, all in the notes. We're not going to go through all of it, but at least it's one place for you to find proofs if you're interested. They're both not super complicated. This one is a lot easier to prove, so we'll prove that one first. So this is basically the answer for the lasso, and we'll go through that in more depth next week. After that, after doing some theory for the lasso, I wanted to talk about related procedures and extensions and things that kind of relate to high-dimensional regression. If we have time, I'll mention a lot of other kind of, let's say, current work that's kind of very relevant. And I haven't written that subsection yet, so unfortunately for you guys, the notes, I keep adding things to them. So if you turn them on, I'm sorry. But the good news is that I'm only ever adding things to the notes, never changing sections I've already written. So if you pull up the notes on the website, say on Monday, and there's like 5 new pages, you can just print out those 5 pages and keep your current pages. So before this lecture, I just added a bunch of theory, but I didn't change any of the stuff that came before that. So you don't have to reprint it. Okay. Any questions before we jump into some of the properties of the lasso? So let's get to some of the basic properties of the lasso. And the first thing I'm going to ask is actually a kind of a simple question, which is uniqueness. So in the higher dimensional case, is the lasso estimate even uniquely defined? Remember we saw that the least squares estimator wasn't uniquely defined. And that posed some problems. One was that we couldn't interpret the coefficients, right? Because we saw that there could be two different solutions that had different signs for the same coefficient. And the other was out-of-sample prediction was impossible, right? If you don't have if it's not a uniquely defined set of coefficients, then you don't have a well-defined way to predict out-of-sample. So we're going to ask those questions about the lasso. And let's start off by saying that from pure convexity theory, if p is bigger than n, then this problem need not have a unique solution. So what you would have learned in the convex optimization course that I taught last semester, or any kind of textbook treatment of optimization, is that strictly convex problems have unique solutions. And strictly convex means that they are everywhere kind of more curvy than a line, than affine functions. And while this isn't strictly convex, think about it as a bunch of like linear functions pieced together. Okay, it's not very curvy, certainly not curvy away from zero. This is curvy, but it's only curvy so long as x transpose x is invertible. If x transpose x is singular, which happens when p is larger than n, then this also has directions in which it's flat. It has directions actually in which the loss doesn't change at all. Those are the directions in the null space of x. So from convexity theory, if p was larger than n, this wouldn't have a unique solution and we'd be in trouble. And what happened to the lasso is actually something kind of remarkable. I don't have a good explanation for why it holds intuitively, but what happens is that these directions in which this is flat don't align in directions in which we can keep the L1 norm constant. So essentially, if we're at a lasso solution, we cannot move in the null space of x and keep the L1 norm constant. Which means that pretty much always the estimate's unique. Even when p is 100,000 and n is 50, it'll still be unique. And people in optimization, I think, would be surprised by that fact because it's an example where you have a problem that's not strictly convex but has a unique solution. So I'll state that in just a few minutes. First, I wanted to mention something that people did before this uniqueness business was maybe carefully studied, which is the elastic net. So if I didn't have, what do they call the second term? If I had x transpose x being singular, so I was in the high dimensional case, but if p was bigger than n, then I could think about taking a combination of the L1 and L2 norms. And this is called the elastic net. And as far as we're concerned, so now here, lambda and delta are both tuning parameters. It guarantees us a unique solution as long as delta is strictly positive, because this provides us the necessary curvature. Right? This thing is strictly convex, so everything's fine. So it's nice because it gives us a well-defined solution always. It also tries to combine the strengths of the lasso and ridge regression. We're not really going to talk about ridge regression much. There's lots of interesting theory we could mention on ridge regression. But just very briefly, ridge regression actually predicts fine, even in high dimensions. It doesn't have poor predictions, generally speaking. It doesn't hurt in terms of, let's say, on the mean scale, predicting the mean, to have coefficients that are small, but not quite zero, which is what ridge regression does. So it doesn't really hurt if we tune this properly to introduce some shrinkage due to the ridge term. It can actually help, it can even help lasso's predictive power because of an issue that we'll mention shortly called saturation of the lasso solution has. Okay, so this is something that may be of interest. We talk about it, you know, for a bit, but I just wanted to mention what it was, and that this would be a fix to basically an obvious fix in the sense to issue uniqueness. Just add a bit of L2 curvature, gives you a well-defined solution, and also actually can help your predictions. Okay, so in contrast, the lasso estimator, right, this guy here, just right below it. Is not always unique. So let's just spend a few minutes on what happens when the solution is not unique, and then we'll talk about conditions under which it is unique, which we'll see are kind of almost all the problems you want to solve. But there are still, I'd say, you know, interesting cases in which it's not unique, so let's think about what happens when it's not unique. So a few basic observations, two facts about the lasso problem. First fact is that the fit values are always unique. Same is true with least squares. So we saw that even if the coefficients were not uniquely defined, the fitted values would be. Also true with the lasso. So these facts are for lambda strictly positive. If lambda is zero, they're just doing least squares. And that was not very hard to see. If you know a bit of convex analysis, this function is strictly convex in this argument. So that makes this uniquely defined as a solution. Okay, if I call this u, then the function f of u, which is the L2 norm squared of y minus u, is strictly convex in u, which makes this unique. Second fact, okay, is that I did the backwards in those. This is supposed to be the saving grace. I wonder if I can remember what the second fact was. The first fact was that this is not always unique. So and there is either one solution or infinitely many solutions. You either have a unique solution or you have infinitely many. Okay, you're in one of those two cases. Seems like it'd be bad to be in this case then, right? From the perspective of kind of well-definedness. And this is because the solution set to any convex problem is convex. So as soon as I have two points in that set, the line segment between them is also in that set, because the infinitely many solutions. Okay. So we're now going to find something called the equicorrelation set, and we're going to see it's a very useful object for the lasso. before we talk about the actual correlation set, we're going to actually just write down what the KKT conditions are for the lasso. So I didn't tell you what these were. That would have maybe taken another half lecture or something. These are a set of optimality conditions that characterize the solutions to any convex problem. And I'm telling you what they are, what they look like for the lasso. Essentially, you can think about them like taking the derivative of that criterion and setting it equal to zero and solving for like what data should look like. Or just, it's a statement that the gradient of that loss function should be equal to zero. Which is what you know from, say, like high school calculus, right? That if I have a convex function, its derivative has to be zero at its minimizer, if it's smooth. For convex criterions in multiple dimensions, it's the gradient if they're smooth, and if they're not smooth, it's something called the subgradient. So it's the generalization of gradients to non-smooth convex functions. In fact, subgradients are actually defined for any function, but they're particularly useful for convex functions. So the KKT conditions in this case, because our problem is unconstrained, they just produce something called subgradient optimality. So they tell us that the gradient of that loss function has to be zero. Solution. Let's see if we can remember our multivariable calculus. What's the gradient of the first term, this least squares loss, with respect to beta, the parameter? Man, who's in my convex class again? I think I said you should tattoo this on your arm, because they always take gradients of quadratics. Okay. I'll give you guys some slack. It's been a long winter break. So that's the gradient of the first term. It's, we're doing the chain rule. So we're taking the unsquare of the thing in the middle, and then we're doing the chain rule. And, well, there's a minus, so I have a minus there. And so this plus something like the gradient of the second term should be zero, but the second term's not differentiable, so we're going to use something called the subgradient. And the subgradient of the L1 norm times lambda is lambda times the sines of the components. And it's kind of like a generalized sine, so I'll tell you what that is in a second. So this must be equal to zero. That's the KKT conditions. That characterizes the lasso solution. Or equivalently, we can write it like this. The inner products of all the variables with the residual must be equal to lambda times the sines of those coefficients. So formally, S is one of three things. So let's say Sj, S is a vector of length p, and Sj is either just one if beta j is positive, it's minus one if beta j is negative, and if beta j is zero, it can be anything in between minus one and one. This is called the subgradient of the this vector is the subgradient of the L1 norm. So the vector of length p, this is what its components look like. J equals 1 to p. So if you can find me a pair of beta, p vector, real value, and s, which is this, satisfies this property, that make this equation true, then you've solved the lasso problem, and that's the solution to the KKT conditions. Okay. You know what? I'm sorry. I introduced the equivalation set a little too early. We're going to mention one fact before that. This immediately tells us kind of a nice fact about the lasso. So let's call this fact three. And that is S is unique at the solution. Why is that true? That's true because, look, S only depends on the fitted values. If I told you what the fitted values were from the lasso, you took the residual, took inner products with all the variables, and divided by lambda, that would uniquely identify S. Because S must make that equation true. And any solution is going to yield the same fitted values, so actually S is unique to itself, right? Which tells us a very useful fact about the lasso, which is that the sines of non-zero coefficients must match at all lasso solutions. So we're never going to have the same problem with interpretation of the least squares. Because if you gave me any lasso solution that have, you know, let's say beta 5 non-zero, then its sign is determined uniquely by the fifth entry of S, which is unique, right? It's either going to be 1 or minus 1, which means that any lasso solution that has the fifth component non-zero has to have that same sign. So we don't have the same problem with interpretation of the least squares. So it's just a very simple fact that comes from the optimality equation. Okay, now we're going to define the equicorrelation set. And this equicorrelation set, which we denote by E, it's just a set of all variables called J, such that xj transpose y minus x beta. I should really put a hat here. This is uniquely determined the solution. Set of all variables j, xj, such that their inner product of the residual is equal to lambda. So it's basically the guys that have the maximal inner product possible with the residual, an absolute value, right? Because s can only be 1 or minus 1 or something in between it. So the equicorrelation set are the guys that should equal correlation, hence the name equicorrelation, and it's also the biggest correlation possible with the residual. And we can also think about it like this. It's a set of all j such that the subgradient vector, which is unique, is this one in absolute value, so it's plus or minus. Okay. And one thing that's useful about this guy, called fact 4, is that E, the set E, contains the active set A. It's bigger than the active set A, or equal to it in the containment, for any